The focus is to organize the work in high-performing cross-functional teams. And what I mean with cross-functional teams, I'll tell you in a minute. And the idea of these high-performing cross-functional teams is they do not only build IT systems, but they also run the IT systems. And the good thing of people that are responsible for also the whole operations is that that makes them more aware of quality by itself. For example, after you have once been called while asleep at Sunday night because one or another problem in your IT system appeared, and then the whole team should fix it, then you will, the next time you will be aware of quality a little more than you may have been in the past. And the last thing, of course, is automation. Since we want to deliver at speed, we need to automate as much as possible. But we have added a small sign here, as long as it is useful, because automation itself is not the goal. The goal is to deliver business value. And if you want to deliver it fast, you may need automation. So when we started creating the book, one of the things we thought about is how does this business value delivery interact with the IT delivery? So on this slide on the top, you see the scope of business delivery, which is the end-to-end scope. And for the business, we define what is the value they want to have. So that's the value definition. And then if you have the value as a goal, we have the rest of this so-called voice model. And voice, as you will see, is made up from the starting letters of the important terms here. So there is business value, and to create business value, we need to support that with IT. So that's why we have the scope of IT delivery. And the first thing is to detail the objectives. What are the objectives we want to reach with IT? And then you need to measure if you are going towards these objectives. And measuring these objectives, that's what we call, of that's done with indicators. Now, and the measuring of these indicators mainly is testing. So testing gives the information you need. And what do you do with this information? This information supports the stakeholders, for example, business people, but also product owners and other people involved. It supports their confidence that we will be able to reach the pursued value. Because while still in the IT delivery area, you can't measure the real value. So you have to have confidence that you will be able to reach the real value. And when you have enough confidence, then you put the software live. And that's where the people from the business or their customers experience the real value. And based on this real value, they get new ideas for value improvement. And that's where you see this loop. So if you work DevOps, for example, in combination with Kanban, then you can go through this value delivery loop multiple times per day. If you would do Scrum, you, for example, have 2-week sprints, you would go through this loop every 2 weeks. And if you would work in a traditional V-model based way of working, then it may be once per month or once per quarter, whatever. So this voice model, it is independent of the way we deliver IT. Actually, this voice model may even help you when transitioning from one to the other type of IT. So, and keep in mind, the indicators are very important because, these indicators, they supply the information needed. And a little bit more about these indicators. So we describe 4 groups of indicators. We have the business value related indicators, the IT delivery related indicators, team related indicators, and problem related indicators. So business value related might, for example, be the number of returning customers. So you can see, they appreciate our system, they come back. IT related may have to do with when we deliver, for example, velocity. team-related indicators. For example, how happy are your team members? Because you want to have a good functioning team. And the more happy people are, the better the team functions. And problem-related indicators is, for example, what problems do we still have outstanding and need to be fixed? Now, in our book, we describe about 1.5 pages of examples of indicators, and still that's not all indicators that are possible. But mainly, you should keep in mind that you define the indicators that are useful to you, and please keep in mind, make it a short list, because you need to measure all these indicators, and you better select a few very to the point indicators than that you select them all and you just end up measuring, but you don't really supply information anymore. And these indicators, they relate to quality and the quality risks. And so quality is what you want to achieve. Quality risks are the things you don't want to have. And together, this is the basis to give you confidence in the pursued value. Like I said, there are multiple IT delivery models. And when we set off, we try to group them because there are so many IT delivery models these days that often is very confusing. So we said there is the sequential IT delivery models, mainly the traditional things like waterfall or V model. And waterfall you hardly see anywhere, but V model you see still quite often. Then we have the high performance IT delivery, for example, Scrum and DevOps, but there are other possibilities as well, like Kanban. And we have hybrid IT delivery, and that is a mix of traditional and high performance. For example, the demand supply model, where the business people still work in a more traditional way. So they first make all their requirements, they hand them over to the supplier, which is the IT people. The IT works in a Scrum way of working and then hands back their results back to the business, who, for example, does an end-to-end test for the whole. And another form of hybrid IT delivery is agile at scale. For example, the scaled agile framework. So that's what we took as an example here. But obviously, by the name of the book, it is about DevOps. So what is DevOps? DevOps, in our opinion, is a culture. DevOps is a system engineering culture. And in DevOps, there are six main activities, the fundamental DevOps activities, which are plan, code, integrate, deploy, operate, and monitor. And we, of course, took a look at many of these infinity loops. Hey, you see a lot of them on the internet. And most of them have the word testing or QA as one of the activities in the loop. And you may notice that we do not have testing or QA in this loop. And that is for a reason, because the testing and QA, which we in general call quality engineering, should be integrated everywhere. Quality engineering is not just an activity somewhere. It is a way of working, living, and thinking that goes across all fundamental activities. Also, in DevOps, there are some principles. And these principles we took from the book, the DevOps Handbook, which you probably know. And the DevOps Handbook, well, probably you can't read it, but it's written by four authors. And one of the authors is Patrick Debois from Belgium. And Patrick also is the one who invented the name DevOps. A long time ago, he organized a conference for developers and operations people. And then he just glued Dev and Ops together. And that's how the name DevOps came along. And actually, we are very proud that the same Patrick Debois has written the foreword in our book. So thanks, Patrick, for that. And like you see, there are some DevOps principles, general principles that are relevant if you try to implement DevOps. And well, most of them probably are familiar to you. We think there is an end-to-end responsibility that's very important, and the responsibility is borne by the cross-functional teams. So you have cross-functional teams, and I'll get back to that in a minute. This is our definition of DevOps, because one of the problems we ran into is there is not one basic all agreed definition. So we took this one. I won't read it out, all of it, but it starts with, it is a cross-functional systems engineering culture. So DevOps is a culture, and the culture, the DevOps culture is supported by an agile mindset. So we work according to the Agile Manifesto, and it can be filled in with a Scrum framework. So DevOps, Agile, and Scrum can all work together in this whole concept. Okay, like I said, teams are very important. It's not about the organization as a whole. It's not about individual people, but it is about teams of people working together. And what is a cross-functional team? In our view, a cross-functional team means we have a team that is capable of doing all activities that are needed, all tasks that are needed. And in the team, you have roles. You have roles and not so much functions. So in this picture, you see a business analyst, a developer, an operations person, and a tester. But these are roles in the team. And any team member can pick up such a role if needed at a certain point in time. Also, no team member has the monopoly on a specific task. So if, for example, somebody who has a operations background, so he's a very skilled operations person, he's doing some testing. During the testing, he finds a problem, and then he would be allowed to fix the problem himself, because these are different tasks, but one team member can pick up different tasks. Of course, it still is wise in such a team to have someone with a big experience and skills in development, for example, because if you want to set up a new, let's say, Java framework, yeah, probably you need someone who's very good at that. But in a cross-functional team, if the very skilled developer is a day off, the work of the whole team simply should continue, because the team as a whole always should have enough skills and capacity to do their job. Now, I show here the basic roles that you see, but of course there are more roles in a cross-functional team. And some roles are more in one area. We have here the three areas: business, development, and operations. And for example, a system architect is mainly involved on the development side. And an operations manager is mainly involved in the operations side. Still, there is overlap between these various areas, but there are some people who are in the middle of it and always are involved in everything, like your Scrum Master or Agile Lead, your product owner, your developer, and obviously the tester. Some people also ask us, hey, but what about security? Because now often we see DevSecOps, and well, we have chosen just to use DevOps as a term. If it's important to you, you may include security people in your team, or it may be that security is a special skill that you get from outside the team once in a while it's needed. Because the basic security skills should be in the team, but sometimes you need very skilled people from beyond your team. So much. Then we're going to do the poll. And oh, I'm afraid I have the wrong Menti code here. But here is the good Menti code. So the idea is you now go to Mentimeter or now menti.com. So here it says you go to menti.com and there you enter the code 247103. And then you can vote for four subjects because the book that we wrote contains 48 chapters and I'll never be able to talk about 48 chapters in just 1 hour. So I give you the possibility to select what subject you would like. And the subjects are, they are first QA and testing topics. In our book, we don't describe QA and testing activities, but we group them into 20 topics. Then we have the test automation and CI/CD pipeline, which are very important when we do DevOps. Then we have unit testing and mutation testing, and that focuses on things that typically traditionally did not get so much focus. So I thought that would be an important subject of today. And we have monitoring, control, reporting, and alerting, which is about how to supply the information and how to act upon the information. So I see already 9 people have voted. I actually don't know how many people exactly are in the webinar right now, so I don't know how many votes to expect, but I'll see how it moves. We still have votes coming in. And that also gives me a moment to have a sip. So currently, currently we are in the somebody is trying to Skype me. That's not very handy. So I see the QA and testing topics are number one and test automation and pipeline currently number two. And actually there's quite a gap towards the number 3 and 4. So I'll wait just 1 other minute to see some votes coming in. In the meantime, I can introduce you to the other people who wrote the book. So here on the left, you see myself. Then you see Dennis Geurts, who is a system architect. Then Berend van Veenendaal, who is an expert backend developer. And on the right, you see Wouter Ruigrok, who is an agile quality coach. So what you see is that we as authors together also were a cross-functional team with various backgrounds and brought all our expertise together. Okay, well, I think we'll close the vote here. So what do we have? I'll make a note. So the first one is QA and testing topics. And the second one is test automation and pipeline. And if somebody is now very much disappointed and would like to know everything about mutation testing, you can always put it in the questions. And then at the end, we still have about 15 minutes Q&A where we can discuss everything that you would like to discuss. Okay, so the first subject is QA and testing topics. So I'll have to switch there. Okay, so you may know that the traditional TMAP had 7 testing activities, and you may know the fundamental testing process of ISTQB, which has, from the top of my mind, I think it's 8 or 9 activities. And one of the things that we were discussing when we started updating TMAP was, what are the activities we need? And quite quickly, we found a huge number of activities in quality engineering. We found over 50, and that's totally unworkable. So then we said we need to group them. And we grouped them to the QA and testing topics. And these QA and testing topics are divided in 2 main groups. So we have organizing topics and performing topics, where the organizing topics are about orchestration, arranging stuff, planning, etc. and performing topics are about doing the actual quality engineering activities. And that's how we came up with this list, and I hope you can read it. I agree that some of the letters may be a little bit small if you're working on a small laptop screen, but I'll give you some examples. For example, I'll start with the first performing topic, because once in a while we get comments that people say, hey, this is not a performing topic, it should be an organizing topic, because people think organizing is test management and performing is test engineering. That's not the case. Organizing is more overall activities, and performing are the things you do, for example, if you work in Scrum, performing are the things you do within a sprint. So quality risk analysis and test strategy are the things you specifically do for the things you are working on in a sprint. And so you want to know what are the risks and where do we put our testing efforts. Whereas, for example, the first organizing topic, quality policy and test policy, that's something you probably don't want to have in every team. You do not want that every team themselves makes a new quality and test policy. You want to have one policy for your whole organization or part of your organization. On the other hand, I do realize that some of the topics maybe not so black and white. Some topics, they relate to organizing as well as to performing. Take, for example, estimating and planning. You may have some overall ideas how to do estimating and planning, but while performing, you need to fill in the details, of course. Then you may wonder some specific topics that are very important in today's DevOps world, and that is infrastructure and tooling. And infrastructure is supported these days, for example, with cloud infrastructure. And what you see is it also changes what people in the teams will have to do. For example, operations people who have the operations role traditionally would go to a computer room and there maybe put some blade servers in a rack or whatever, and they had all this hardware to work on. But today they mainly work with infrastructure as code. So they just define in some code lines what kind of infrastructure they desire, and then out of the cloud they get it delivered. And also they use some infrastructure verification to check whether the infrastructure they have gotten still does what it is supposed to do and works properly. And tooling, that's also something that goes with organizing, because you do not want each and every tool to each and every team to decide on their own tools. So you want to have an overview of that. Of course, teams need to be able to get the tools they should have, but they should not get each and every tool. And we'll get back to tools in the pipeline, because you also selected the pipeline. So now you may wonder, how do these topics relate to the DevOps activities? Remember the six fundamental DevOps activities, and we have 20 topics. How do we bring them together? For example, does quality and test policy only relate to plan? Well, our idea with this is no. Our idea is these topics, they relate to any DevOps activity. So in the middle of this picture, you see DevOps activities, the six fundamental DevOps activities, and around that you see the two rings with the organizing topics and the performing topics. And of course, some topics have quite a strong relationship with a few specific DevOps activities, but most of the topics relate to multiple, if not all, DevOps activities. So therefore, don't think there should be a one-on-one relationship. Yeah, that's what I think I should tell about the topics. And like you see, we think these topics are very important because they are even on the cover of our book. Only here they are styled a little bit differently because every topic has got its own icon so that we can easily refer to these topics. And what you may also notice is that some topics have two words in them, like monitoring and control. They are closely related things and we made one topic of them. And because like I already said, we have more than 50 relevant things and we group them together. Sometimes it is somewhere in the word head, like take for example test design, and we have the word test design here as a performing topic. And test design is an overarching term for coverage-based testing, like using test design techniques, but also for experience-based testing, like doing exploratory testing or mob testing or crowd testing. So all of that we have fitted under the topic of test design. Let's then go to the other one you selected, and that is the test automation and CI/CD pipeline. And that's not this one. So, oh, just a moment, I'll have to look up where it is. There it is. Sorry for that. Test automation and pipeline. Well, I already showed to you that we thought the topics are very important. They're on the front cover of the book. On the back cover, we have the pipeline. So I'm not very surprised that you as an audience has selected these two subjects to discuss because, well, I'm very glad that you agree with us that these are the two most important subjects. So let's first have a look at a CI/CD pipeline. Now, there are very, very many pictures of CI/CD pipelines. And what we try to do is just give an overview of what a CI/CD pipeline is consisted of. And what you see here is first the CI part of the pipeline, and that is the continuous integration part. So continuous integration is where all the, also called the build pipeline, that's where all the activities happen that are within the scope of one team. That's why it ends with the team test stage. So at the end of the build pipeline, this is where the, all the tests are done, preferably automatically, of course, because we want to automate as much as possible. So this is where the changes in the IT products are done. They are built together, brought into the main branch, tested, and then they can be deployed to the CD part of the pipeline, where CD stands for continuous deployment. You also see CD as in the meaning of continuous delivery. And in our view, the difference between continuous delivery and continuous deployment is that with continuous delivery, you deliver to somewhere else. And with continuous deployment, you deploy all the way to production. So in a continuous deployment setup, the ideal situation is that you automatically go through the whole pipeline and then put it live. Well, let's have a look at the release pipeline part. The first thing you there see is the business test stage. And that doesn't mean that you ask business people to come and do testing, but it means that at that stage, you do testing with a business perspective. And one of the things you could do there is the end-to-end regression testing. Because often if you're in a larger organization with multiple teams, then the individual teams don't have a view on all the whole end-to-end business process. So therefore, you need to test with a specific view for in your team in the build pipeline. Okay? So you only test the stuff that your team can influence and that is beyond the reach of your team. And then in the release pipeline, there you will have the test of the overall part. And preferably, especially in a larger organization, such a end-to-end regression test is done by a separate supporting team. So it's not one of the teams that develop and run parts of the system, but is a supporting team that does end-to-end testing. Especially in larger organizations, that will work well. And in small organizations, if you have two or three teams, then the teams should work together to do this business test stage. And finally, when everything works well, it's deployed to production. And that's where it's really live. Now, everywhere you see this continuous monitoring and this continuous feedback loop. At the top, you see continuous testing and continuous quality assurance in general is part of the continuous monitoring. And from all stages in your pipeline, you can have feedback. And that feedback is then used to improve stuff. So if you find there's something wrong somewhere, you have feedback and you loop back. And then there's one other very important thing with pipelines. Often, if you see pictures of CI/CD pipelines or hear people talking about CI/CD pipelines, they are talking about the tools in the pipeline. Now, it is my belief that tools are, of course, important because you want to automate as much as possible. But which tool to choose is not very important because tools change very often and there are very many tools out there. So the tool itself doesn't matter that much. Therefore, we think it's very important that you think about the capabilities that you need in your CI/CD pipeline. And we have five groups of capabilities that are important. Continuous integration tools, continuous delivery tools, continuous deployment tools, continuous monitoring tools, and continuous quality and testing tools. And if you think about the capabilities you need, if you think about the capabilities you need, then you construct the image of what kind of pipeline you need. And then you can find the tools to fill in these capabilities. And some tools are able to fill in multiple capabilities. And I have seen examples where there was a pipeline that had a great number of tools, whereas some of these tools could have done a lot more, and then you will end up with less tools and thus less maintenance. So keep in mind, you want to know the capabilities in your CI/CD pipeline and fill in the capabilities with tools. And if a tool changes because a new tool comes around, then you can simply look, does this tool do something we need the capability of? If so, we can exchange this tool or add this tool, whatever. Then a little bit on test automation. There are two well-known ideas about testing and especially to define what variety in testing you need and what test automation you need. And they are the testing pyramid and the testing quadrant. But first, I would like to introduce a very brief piece of terminology. Because you all have heard of the word regression testing, where we test something that should not have been changed to see if it indeed has not been changed. And then people ask me, what is the other thing for regression testing. So the opposite of regression testing. And there was no real word for that. So I think it, the first time when this started was like 5 years ago, when I suggested to some fellow QA and testing experts to use the word progression testing. And some people liked it right away, other people not so much. And it, yeah, we just kept it going on for some time. And then when we were working on this new book, we decided progression testing is a term that most people understand. And it's good to be able to say, okay, we do regression testing for the unchanged part. We do progression testing for the new and changed part. And of course, we also have some confirmation testing or retesting to test the actual fixes of problems. Okay, let's go to the testing pyramid. Probably you have seen or heard about the testing pyramid before. And I think all of the testing pyramid pictures that you have seen so far actually were triangle pictures and not pyramid pictures. And in this testing pyramid, you see the levels of test automation. And the idea of the test automation pyramid is that you automate as low as possible. So most of the test automation should be on unit test level. So you test small bits of code, and if they work well, then you can combine them, and then you start testing on integration level or API test level for the interfaces. So that's the middle layer of the testing pyramid. And if you want to test your business process, especially more end-to-end style testing, then you use graphical user interface testing. And these GUI tools traditionally were the tools where most of the test automation happened. So that's why this test automation pyramid was created, to make people aware that you should not do too much through the GUI, because GUI testing is very prone to changes. So you have to do a lot of maintenance on your testing as well. And also it takes much more time to run these tests because, for example, unit testing, it tests small pieces of code and goes very quickly. Whereas in GUI testing, you often have to build in weights because there is some delay and some latency. So the running of these tests takes much longer. And on the top of the testing pyramid, you see some manual testing, because always still some manual testing will remain needed. For example, some exploratory testing to check for strange situation or uncommon situation, and also some testing where it simply would not pay off to automate it, because some automation simply has no return on investment. Now, what did we add to the testing pyramid and make it an actual pyramid? That's the thing on the left, where you see the manual testing. Manual testing done by the people who create the test automation. Because as most test automation engineers will recognize, that while preparing your automated test, you also have to test your automated test. And while doing that, you will discover a lot about the quality of the system you are testing. And so it is a well-known fact that most of the defects and anomalies that are found during automated testing are actually found while trying out the automated test. Because most automated testing is regression test style testing. And with a regression test, typically you don't want it to find anomalies, because there shouldn't be any failures in your regression test, because you test something that already was good. So it should not have been changed. So therefore, we thought it was important to add to the testing pyramid this notion of still manual testing is involved. And this also helps to explain to especially managers who are responsible for giving budget for test automation, who often say, yeah, but I just buy a tool and then I don't need these people anymore. Well, that it may help them to convince them otherwise. And we have the testing quadrants. And the testing quadrants is a well-known concept. If I'm not mistaken, initially set up by Brian Merrick, later adjusted by Lisa Crispin and Janet Gregory, and multiple other people have done things with it as well. And what you see is it has four quadrants that help you define how to implement your testing and how to make variety in your testing. And on the bottom side, you see technology. So on the vertical axis, it's technology and business. These are the perspectives. And on the left and the right, you see guiding the team and assessing the product. So in the corner left, the left lower corner, that's where technology is used to guide the team. For example, by using unit testing with test-driven development, where you first define the test cases and then run the tests and then create software to where you make the unit tests using test-driven development so that the tests are actually guiding the team making the right software. The same happens with business perspective. You can do acceptance test-driven development or business-driven development, and then use that also to guide the team to build the right system. So that's where test automation is helping the team. On the right, we're assessing the product. So on the top right quadrant, you see the business perspective for assessing the product, and that's with an end user view. And it says mainly manual, but it's not without purpose that it says mainly, because here still you can do automated testing, for example, automated regression testing of your end-to-end process, and maybe even some more automation. But also, this is typically where you will do manual testing. And then on the right lower side, you see the technical perspective of assessing the product. And that's, for example, where the non-functional testing is, like performance testing, security testing, etc. Now, keep in mind, these quadrants help you to define and identify what kind of testing and test automation you need. It is not the order in which you should do things. So don't think that performance testing and security testing are at the very end, because that's not true. The performance testing and security and all the other non-functionals also should be already involved in the early stages. And so this helps you define the variety in your testing. Well, that's what brings me to the end of these subjects. And looking at the clock, yeah, we must go to the Q&A. Let's go to the Q&A. Oh, and I would like to show this slide. So TMAP is the body of knowledge for quality engineering in all IT delivery. And we have some training courses together with ISKI. And we'll do a specific webinar on these training courses. I think it's 30 June, but you will notice it later. Let's go to the Q&A, Ronan.
Great. Perfect. Thank you, Rick. Thank you for your presentation today. I'm just going to show my screen again. So we're in straight into the questions. And we'll get straight down to it. So just a reminder, everyone, that if you want to submit questions, use the question tab in the at the box on the side. So you'll see that there, and you can submit questions there. So if any questions for Rick now, please submit them there. So Rick, first of all, thanks for a great presentation today. It was really thorough. I think you got through a lot. So I think it was very beneficial for anyone watching today. And there is a few questions coming up already, so we'll get straight into them. So the first question here is from Nicola, and she's a very practical question for you. My manager wants to improve quality in the team. We operate in a Scrum methodology. Where to start?
Where to start? Yeah, it depends. If your manager wants to improve quality in your team, probably the manager has the idea that there's not enough quality, and that may be in there's not enough skills in the team, or it's the way the people in the team work together. And that's a very important difference, because if you have enough skills, it may be that you have to train people, or it may be that there are some very specific skills that you can get from outside, like my example with security. If the way the people work together is not going well, then it is key to work on the interpersonal skills, both within the team, but also maybe from the team to outside the team. So basically it's about skills, the hard skills like IT skills, and the personal and interpersonal so-called soft skills. That's where I would start.
Okay, that's a good stepping point for you, Nicola. Another question here from Khaldun. I hope I'm pronouncing your name right. And they say, Rick, great webinar. Thank you for that, Khaldun. And the question then is about, let me just read it here. So the question I have is, do we still have DevOps if manual testing by a business team is part of the pipeline? I mean, wouldn't that break the automated cycle?
If you start doing DevOps, it is an illusion to think that you can automate everything from the start. So I think there's not a big problem if you still have manual testing in your pipeline. The only thing is that you must then realize that you can't do releases each moment you like, because there's some delay there. Later, during your maturity process, you will automate more and more. And what you ultimately probably will do is delay some of the testing until after you have gone in production. Because one of the things we describe in our book is about testing in production, and it also has to do with observability. So make sure that you are able to see what's happening. And if the quality is not good enough, then you should be able to reverse things, which you, for example, can do with release toggles. So I would definitely not say you are not doing DevOps if some manual tasks are still done.
Okay, great. Another question here from Karina. And the question is, what is new with the new team app?
What is new with the new team app? Well, yeah. a lot of things are new. For example, these QA and testing topics are new. But also the whole team perspective. So we describe quality engineering as a term for that the whole team should be aware of quality and should striving towards quality. And it is not that some people develop something and then they hand it over to some people to test it, but the team as a whole is working to deliver quality at speed. And there are many more detailed things that are also new to the new team app. And also we changed some things that were slightly outdated. So we updated them to have a new and, well, fitted to the current IT world setup.
Okay, that's a good question. We have a question here from Umar then. He's new to testing by the sounds of it. And he just has a quick question. Any QA books for beginners or any other resources you'd recommend for QA beginners?
Well, I would recommend this book, of course, Quality for DevOps, because we wrote it with the perspective of everybody in the team, not just testers. And if you like more details, well, of course, if you ask me, I think there are multiple good books in the Team App series. But there are also many other good books. And if I may name one for a beginner in testing, then let me show it to you. That's good of being in my home office. Get this book, the book Perfect Software and Other Illusions by Jerry Weinberg. That's one of the books I would recommend that's not from my own company. You'll find a very lot of useful knowledge there.
Chris, and while we are plugging, I would recommend eurostarhuddle.com, Umar, because that's full of resources. So there's free webinars, ebooks, yeah, blog posts, everything there. So check that out as well. Chris.
Well, actually, now that you are mentioning it, Ronan, last summer, July, I published the Eurostar ebook that is about test design, which is also a topic in this new book. So, yeah.
There you go. So, Umar, there's plenty of resources there. And Umar's just asked to repeat the name of the book. So
I don't know if you can read it on the screen. I'll try to.
Yeah, so it's Umar. Yes.
And Other Illusions About Testing. But if you just Google for Weinberg and testing, you will find a lot of books by Jerry Weinberg.
Definitely. He's got it, so that's great. Thank you, Umar, for that question. And a question here then as well is, do you have any tips for working virtually as a team? So consider most people are working from home. Have you any tips working?
Yeah. We have learned a lot about working from home in the last couple of months, of course.
Yeah.
One of the tips is, try also to build in some informal stuff, like a regular coffee hour or something like that, or do a game night together. Because normally at work, you have almost natural, you have these, besides you're talking about your hobbies, vacations, whatever, but working remotely, the focus is always on the actual work. And I think it's very important for a team to also still have this feeling of being a team and working together and being more than just people that hand over tasks to each other.
Okay, great. That's a good one. Another question then here from Aram. And it was a simple question, mightn't be an easy answer, but how do you know if DevOps is right for my organization? How do I know?
Well, I would say basically DevOps is right for any organization because the idea of DevOps is that you make people responsible for development and operations. And as you may notice, many companies are trying to adopt a DevOps way of working and a DevOps culture. If, however, you are an organization that knows exactly what's needed, but it takes a lot of effort, then the traditional V model approach may just be good as well. I'm myself in IT for a very, very long time. And I remember that I was in a DevOps team in the mid 80s when nobody had ever heard of the term DevOps. But what we did was we developed stuff and we made sure it stayed working. So we also operated the computers. So we already operated as a sort of DevOps team. But I've also worked in very large organizations where you cannot build something in 2 week cycles because it's very complex, big stuff that you first need to make a large system architecture and then build all sorts of components before actually something is working. So yeah, it depends a bit on your situation, but my observation is that many more companies could work DevOps than currently do. So I think as a lot of is still to gain.
Okay, great. We still have loads of questions coming in, so we'll try we'll maybe take three or four more questions and then we'll probably wrap up there. So I have a question here from Karina again. So follow-up question is, what makes TMAP so successful? What is the key?
I think, well, the key thing that makes TMAP successful is that it's based on experience, because we gather experience from all sorts of people with all sorts of backgrounds, with all sorts of organizations. Like in the thank you of this book, we have more than 80 people, but also keep in mind that TMAP started off 25 years ago. We just celebrated the 25 year anniversary of TMAP. And over these years, we have published, I don't know the exact number, but more than 10 different books. And all of them were based on practical experience. So it's not just theoretical ideas, but it's actually been done, and it's gathered from all over the world. In this book, we have 11 countries represented in the people that were working on the book. So I think these are key elements, and also having a website at tmap.net helps a lot, because almost everything we have created is accessible on the website. And also we encourage people to add things to the website, because it's a body of knowledge, just like the Eurostar huddle. It's a body of knowledge for testing where we encourage people to add things, and that may be things like blogs, but that may be also snippets of code or examples or checklists or whatever. So I think that's what makes it successful.
Okay, great. That's a great answer. A question here from Andreas, and I don't know if Andreas is trying to catch you out or not, but they ask about the pyramid. So I said the pyramid has three visible sides. So what can we expect to see on the backside of your pyramid?
Well, of course, it still is a model, and we have two sides of the model used. So I don't know of any backside of the pyramid, but if you have suggestions, please come.
Okay, so there you go, Andreas. If you have suggestions for Rick, get in touch. A question there from Gareth then. Can you explain the responsibility of a team if you let another service team do the E2E tests in the CD pipeline? As a team, you're not living on an ELAND. I don't know if that's a mistype. So I don't know if you make that question make sense, Rick.
Yeah, okay. So indeed, if you are in a company with just one DevOps team, then one DevOps team is responsible for running everything. But if you are in a large organization, let's say a large bank, insurance company, whatever, they often have 50 teams or even more. And then you always have some supporting teams. If you follow the SAFe framework, the scaled agile framework, you have system teams, you have shared services. And these are typically where you could also have these end-to-end regression tests. And also there will be some shared responsibility for the overall business process. So agile at scale is, well, for it's not without reason that there are multiple approaches to agile at scale, because agile at scale is quite hard. I hope this answers the question.
Okay, I hope to answer the question for you, Gareth. I think we're going to leave it there. So we've already run over time, so we've had a lot of interest today. So thank you very much, Rick, for staying with us today and for that very comprehensive webinar. Gareth says, yes, it did. So I think you answered his question. So that's great to hear. So folks, just to remind you before we go that this webinar will be on eurostarhuddle.com later today, so you'll be able to watch it back if you want to even share with your team members or anything like that, or watch it back yourself. You'll be able to watch it back then. As well as that, as Rick mentioned, he has other publications on eurostarhuddle.com related to the topic he's talking about today, so he has an ebook there as well. So you can find that if you just search for Rick's name on yoursarhuddle.com. You'll be able to find his other resources there. And as well as that, over 1,000 resources, over ebooks, webinars, blogs, and podcasts. So there's loads to find for whether you're new to testing or a very experienced tester or changing your processes. There's something there for everyone. So, Rick, I want to say thank you very much for presenting today.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thank you, Ronan. Thank you all viewers. And have fun with quality engineering.
Great. And I wish the same to everyone as well. Have fun. And we'll talk to you with our next webinar, which is on tomorrow. But from now, for me, bye-bye. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.